Okay, so let me continue. Last time I gave an introduction in double operator integrals, and let me remind the following estimate that is actually very important for many inequalities. Suppose that A and B are self-adjoint operators. Then we have the following inequality. Here, f is an L infinity function on the real line, and the Fourier transform is supported in the interval minus sigma, sigma. Okay, now let me show how to use this inequality to prove that if f is a Hilder function of order alpha, then it is operator Hilder. So suppose alpha is between 0 and 1, f is a Hilder function, which means that f of x minus f of y is less than or equal to a constant times modulus x minus y to the power alpha, then f is operator Hilder. The norm of f of a minus f of b is less than or equal to a constant times, say, 1 minus alpha to the minus 1 times the norm of f in lambda alpha times the norm of f a minus b to the power alpha. So it is operator Hilder of the same order alpha, but here we have a constant that depends on alpha. Actually, if alpha approaches 0, then the constant remains bounded. But if alpha approaches 1, then the constant goes to infinity, which is natural, because otherwise we would have the following fact, that a Lipschitz function is operator Lipschitz, which we know is wrong. Okay, how to see this? We can see the following functions, Wn. This is the Fourier transform of the function Wn. Wn are functions in L1, and the norms of Wn are uniformly bounded, and Vn is the following. The Fourier transform of Vn is this function. This is 1. And this is 1. Okay, then we let me introduce notation. Fn is f convolution with Wn. Then we can represent f as the sum of the Fn, where n is ranges over all integers. Actually, the question in which sense this series converges is not quite trivial. I'm not going to discuss in detail. I can say that if you take the derivatives of the left-hand side and the right-hand side, then we have uniform convergence. Okay, then.
The point is that the sum of Fourier transform Wn, if you sum them up, you get 1.
Except at the origin. The origin is 0. Okay. Then we have the following. The norm of f of a minus f of b is less than or equal to the sum over all integers fn of a minus fn of b. And we can also write it in the following way. It's the sum from minus infinity to capital N, where capital N will be chosen later, fn of a minus fn of b plus f star vn of a minus f star vn of b. Pardon? No, no, it's not, no. Oh, yes, yes, certainly, the norm, yes. Yes, 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 definitely. Yes, yes, certainly. Okay, then let me first estimate this. This is a bounded function. This is a bounded function, and the norm of f star vn of a minus f star vn of b is less than or equal to the sum of the norms, and each norm is less than or equal to the L infinity norm of this convolution. So it's less than or equal to 2 times the L infinity norm of this convolution, which is a consequence of the spectral theorem. And this is, since f is a Hilbert function of order alpha, then it's well known that this norm, this is the L infinity norm, is less than or equal to a constant times f, the norm of f in lambda alpha times 2 to the minus n alpha. Now it's time to choose capital N. We choose capital N in the following way, that 2 to the minus n is almost the same as the norm of a minus b. This is our choice of, say, capital N. Then once we have chosen capital N, we can write that this is less than or equal to a constant times the norm of f in lambda alpha times the norm of a minus b to the power alpha. Okay, when we estimated this norm, actually we get a constant that doesn't depend on alpha. Okay, now let's estimate this norm. And here we use this fundamental inequality. Because in this, if you consider fn, sigma is equal to 2 to the power n plus 1. The Fourier transform of this convolution is supported in the interval 2 to the minus n plus 1, 2 to the n plus 1. So by this fundamental inequality, the sum from minus infinity to n, the norm of fn of a minus fn of b, is less than or equal to the sum from minus infinity to n, 2 to the minus 2 to the minus n times the norm of a minus b. Okay, then again we can write it in the following way. This is 2 to the minus a minus b to the power alpha, 2 to the alpha n. Oh, sorry, no, this is not correct, I'm sorry. Okay. Okay, so this is less than or equal to the sum 2 to the n, 2 to the minus n alpha times the norm of times the norm of fn in L infinity, I'm sorry, times the norm of fn in L infinity.
Why this estimating windows is holds true?
Is it the definition of n?
We select capital N. This is our selection of capital N.
N is positive?
No, doesn't matter.
Okay.
It may be negative.
But also positive?
Pardon?
Also it's positive?
It can be positive, can be negative, depends on the norm of A minus B.
Ah,
the norm of A minus B can be very little, can be very large. Okay, times the norm of F in lambda alpha, because the norm of Fn in L infinity, this is just a very well-known property of Lipschitz-Hölder functions, is less than or equal to 2 to the minus n alpha times the norm of f in lambda alpha times the norm of a minus b. And this is the sum from minus 3 to n. Now we have a geometric series, so it's less than or equal to a constant times 1 minus alpha to the power minus 1 times the norm of f in lambda alpha times the norm of a minus b to the power alpha. Again, we use this selection of capital N. And so we are done.
Your choice here, when you made this, when you started out with this inequality and this inequality, maybe it's inequality by the way, then before, because now you have a triangle inequality, but why is it, if you sum up this Fourier transform of Wn from minus infinity to n,
yes,
you get
If you take the sum from minus infinity to n and add this, you get something identical equal to 1.
But I think it's going to be the other way around. You need to add from n to plus infinity, no? Because you want something which is, when you start from minus infinity, you're going to get.
We get something which is very close to
add up to some point.
Yes, and we get this, exactly this.
You want something which is complementary to that, no? Something you need 1 minus this one. Maybe I don't understand.
One moment. Okay, I'm sorry. It must be F minus this. F minus this. You are right. Yes. And still, and again, still we have this estimate because we estimate terms to L infinity norm of F. Okay. We can also obtain a generalization to this of this result to functions in the space lambda omega, where omega is an arbitrary modulus of continuity. And then we can prove the following, that f, if f belongs to lambda omega, which means that modulus f of s minus f of t is less than equal to constant times omega of modulus s minus t. Question? Of modulus s minus t, then the following holds: f of a minus f of b is less than or equal to a constant times omega star of the norm of a minus b. Where, what is omega star? Omega star of s is integral s times integral from s to infinity omega of t over t squared dt. And this is true for an arbitrary modulus of continuity omega. And this is the result of my joint paper with Alexandrov. Okay, now, as I promised last time, I'm going to demonstrate how double operator integrals can be used in the trace formula by Lifshitz and Crane. So what is that? Suppose that A and B are self-adjoint operators and we know that the difference is a trace class operator. Then first, this formula first was discovered by Lifshitz in 30 special cases, and then Mark Grigorievich Crane proved this formula in the general case when A and B are arbitrary self-adjoint operators with difference in trace class. Then, what is that? Here, xi is a special function which is called the spectral shift function. The spectral shift function, and it is determined uniquely by the pair of A and B and doesn't depend on F. And this formula holds for sufficiently nice functions. Crane proved this formula under the assumption that the derivative is the Fourier transform of an L1 function. Then I proved it under weaker assumption that if F belongs to the Bessel space B infinity 1, 1, then the same is true. This formula holds. But what is interesting is that if you look at this integral actually makes sense for an arbitrary Lipschitz function F. If F is a Lipschitz function, then definitely this integral makes sense. And Crane asked the question whether this formula can be extended to the case when F is an arbitrary Lipschitz function. The answer is no. Again, it was Farfarovskaya who constructed a Lipschitz function F such that, and a pair of operators such as A minus B in S1, but F of A minus F of B doesn't belong to S1. So the this difference doesn't have to be in trace class, and so the answer to Crane's question is negative. Nowadays we know that this property is equivalent to be operator Lipschitz. So F preserves trace class perturbations in this sense, if and only if F is operator Lipschitz. And we know that, for example, the function modulus X is not operator Lipschitz. But here it's important to when I said this, it's important to consider also unbounded operators, not only bounded operators. A and B are allowed to be unbounded, but the difference must be in trace class. Now, let me demonstrate the Biermann-Salamiak approach to this problem using the used double operator integrals. First, let me make the following general observation. If we have, again, due to Biermann and Salamiak, suppose we have a double operator integral. And this time, the spectral measures are the same. And T is a trace class operator. Then how to compute the trace of this? The trace of this can be computed in the following way. It is just the integral over the diagonal phi of x, x trace TE. If E is a spectral measure, trace DTE. D trace TE. Okay. Pardon?
DE. On the
left hand side.
2 times x.
Oh, here. Yeah, yes. Right. Yes, thank you. So we integrate over the diagonal. And here we have the spectral measure, the trace of T times E. E is a spectral measure, and the trace of this is a scalar measure. It's a signed measure. It's a signed measure. Okay. Now let's return to this. We use the one parametric family. AT is A plus T B minus A. And consider the function f of AT. Then we know that the derivative of this function at the point, say U, is the double operator integral f of S1 minus f of S2 divided by S1 minus S2 d e u of S1. Here we have k, where k is b minus a d e u of S1. S2, yes. And this derivative exists in the trace norm. This derivative exists in trace norm. Last time I explained that if the difference is bounded, then the derivative exists in the operator norm. But if a minus b is in trace class, then the same reasoning shows that the derivative exists in the trace norm. And here I can assume that f is a function in the Bessel space. Then we can compute the trace of this derivative using this formula. And the trace of this, of the derivative, is the integral. What is the value of this function on the diagonal? Is the derivative. Is the integral of the derivative of f of s d of e times of trace e of times a times k. Okay, and we see that actually, this linear functional on the class of derivatives of f is a measure. It's a measure. Actually, it's exactly this measure. This is a measure. This is a scalar measure. And now we, if you want to compute the trace of f of a minus f of b, so we have computed the trace of the derivative. Now we have to integrate. Let me denote this measure by mu t. We just integrate from 0 to 1 of mu t dt. Pardon, f prime. And this integral is a measure. Let's call it mu. So we get the following formula. The integral, the trace of f of a minus f of b is the integral of f prime d mu, where mu is a measure. Okay, the approach of Biermann-Salamiak does not actually prove that mu is absolutely continuous. But if we also use the Crane theorem, then we see that mu must be, because Crane's formula holds for the spectral shift function sigma xc, and the Biermann-Salamiak formula holds for this measure mu. Then there is no other possibility other than that mu is absolutely continuous and its Radon-Nikodym derivative coincides with xc. And this reasoning immediately generalizes Crane theorem to arbitrary functions in the Bessel space B infinity 1 1. Okay, let's go ahead. Now let's consider to use what?
Is there a way to use this continuity independently of phrases?
No, it would be nice, but at least I don't know this. And well, you can certainly repeat the argument by Crane, and you get absolute continuity. Yeah, it would be nice to see from this argument that mu is absolutely continuous. But actually, what is nice with this argument that first of all it it gives us this formula. The proof of the existence of mu is considerably simpler than the proof given by Crane. It takes a few lines. And also it allows us to prove, immediately allows us to, Birmans and Mack did not do it, they used more restrictive assumptions, but once we know that for this function, the function f of at is differentiable, then it immediately allows us to extend the Lipschitz-Crane formula to the base of class B infinity 1-1. Okay. Now let's consider the following problem. Now suppose that we have normal operators, not self-adjoint operators. And one and two are normal operators on Hilbert space. And then we want to estimate f of n1 minus f of n2 in terms of n1 minus n2. Here f is a function on the complex plane of what is the same on the space R2. Okay, natural thought would be to try to use the same approach and write the formula f of n1 minus f of n2 equals the integral, double operator integral, of f of zeta 1 minus f of zeta 2 over zeta 1 minus zeta 2 d e1, where e1 is the spectral measure of the first normal operator, times n1 minus n2 times d e2. Okay, if this is an operator Lipschitz function, then everything is fine, the formula holds, and we can make the conclusion that f is a, if this is a Schur multiplier, then we can make the same conclusion that f is operator Lipschitz and everything is fine. For which f, this divided difference is operator Lipschitz. Okay, only for linear functions. If the divided difference is operator Lipschitz, is Schur multiplier, excuse me, then f is a linear function. F of z is az plus b only in this case.
Very nice class.
Yes, and certainly this function is operator Lipschitz, definitely. But actually you can see that there are other operators. You can immediately see that there are other operator Lipschitz functions. For example, the function z bar is also operator Lipschitz. But for the function z bar, this is not a Schur multiplier. Okay, so how to get sufficient condition for operator Lipschitzness. This time we consider slightly different double operator integrals. We have the following formula, f of n1 minus f of n2. Here we have the following representation, n1 is a1 plus ib1, and 2 equals a2 plus ib2. Where A1 is the real part of N1, B1 is the imaginary part of N1. So A1 and B1 are commuting self-adjoint operators. And the same with A2 and B2. And this is the sum of the following operator, double operator integrals. Well, again, this formula holds if those two divided difference, we can say the divided difference is just in one variable, are sure multipliers. But in this case, the situation is actually much brighter. So we want to obtain nice conditions for the divided difference to be sure multipliers. And actually, the same result holds as in the case of functions on the real line. Suppose that f is a bounded function, and the Fourier transform of f is supported in minus sigma squared. Then the, let me use notation dx f and dy f for the second divided difference. Then both divided differences, dx f, are sure multipliers, and the sure multiplier norm is less than or equal to a constant times the L infinity norm of f times times sigma. Times sigma. As in the case of functions in one variable. Okay, how to get it? Okay, this time we are going to use the characterization of the space of sure multipliers in terms of Hoggerup tensor product of infinity spaces. We write the following: f of x1 y minus f of x2 y over x1 minus x2 is the sum of over n f of n pi f of n pi y minus f of x2 y divided by n pi minus x2 times sine x1 minus n pi divided by x1 minus n pi. And here we assume that sigma is equal to 1. If sigma is greater than 1, this formula can be easily adjusted. Okay, this expansion holds and. Okay, now this is exactly a representation of this divided difference as a tensor product. So we separated variables, and actually the Hoggerup tensor product can be estimated very easily. The sum of sine x1 minus n pi squared divided by x1 minus n pi squared is identically equal to 1. This is a very well known formula. So this means that the L2 norms are uniformly bounded. Actually, they're equal to 1. And the sum of n pi y minus f of x2 y squared divided by n pi minus x2 squared is less than or equal to, I think, 3 times the norm of f squared at the space of infinity. So this is exactly the Hoggerup tensor product. And so we can make the conclusion that the sure multiplier norm of this is the sure multiplier norms of this are actually uniformly bounded by the L infinity norm of f. And if sigma, here we consider the case sigma equal to 1, but if sigma is an arbitrary number, then we also get the factor of sigma. And we can prove all the results now as in the case of self-adjoint operators. In particular, if we have a function in the Bessel space, B infinity 1, 1, of two variables, then f is operator Lipschitz. Again, if we have a Hilder function, then f is operator Hilder of the, with the same index alpha. Also, I have not mentioned this, it in the case of function of one variables, but I can mention it here, that if p is greater than 1 and n1 minus n2 belongs to the Schottner von Neumann class SP, then f of n1 minus f of n2 belongs to SP over alpha. F belongs to Hilder class lambda alpha. Then the difference f of n1 minus f of n2 belongs to the Schottner von Neumann class SP over alpha. SP over alpha. Okay, so practically all the results which we have obtained for functions of one variable can be also obtained for functions of two variables, for functions of normal operators. Okay, now we get the following situation. Okay, studying functions of normal operators is the same as studying functions of two commuting self-adjoint operators, because we can consider A1 and B1. And they're commuting self-adjoint operators. What happens if we have more than two commuting operators? Suppose we have triple of commuting self-adjoint operators or quadruples, etc. Actually, this method does not work at all. Not only it doesn't work, but it can be proved that if we consider more than two variables, three variables, then we have three operator differences, then one of them is not a sure multiplier. It's just not a sure multiplier. In my joint paper with Fyodor Nazarov, we actually found another method that also works for any collection of commuting self-adjoint operators. And we can obtain a similar inequality in terms of the exponential type sigma. But the method is completely different. Okay, now let me proceed to multiple operator integrals. So far, I have considered only double operator integrals. Okay. There were many attempts to define multiple operator integrals, but until recently, the assumptions were very, very restrictive. And 10 years ago, I defined multiple operator integrals for the following functions. For functions, again, let's take projective tensor products or integral projective tensor products. Let me, for simplicity, use the projective tensor product, but as in the case of double operator integrals, we can always extend this definition to integral projective tensor products. So suppose that phi belongs to this tensor product, which means that phi of S1, S2, S3 can be represented as the following sum. Phi of S1, psi of S2, chi of S3, and the sum of the norms of the products, phi n, psi n, chi n, phi n in L infinity, norm psi n of L infinity, the norm of chi n in L infinity is fine. And this is the case of double operator integrals. Here we cannot use the approach by Biermann and Salamiak. They started with the case of Hilbert-Schmidt operators. There is no way we can do it for triple operator integrals or for multiple operator integrals. For simplicity, I write the formulas for triple operator integrals, but the same can be done if you had more space on the blackboard, the same can be done for multiple operator integrals. Okay, then we can define this case, the triple operator integral, phi dE1, t dE2, r dE3, as the following sum integral of phi 1, phi n dE1, t integral of psi n dE2, r integral of chi n dE3. As in the case, I use this formula in the case of double operator integrals. And let me now use this formula as a definition. Again, this formula can be generalized to integral tensor products. But actually, this in the case of double operator integrals, there was no problem with the fact that this the right-hand side actually doesn't depend on the choice of this representation. This representation is not unique. In the case of double operator integrals, there was no such problem because we had a definition by duality that doesn't depend, and the definition was absolutely invariant under this representation. So there was no problem with proving that the right-hand side doesn't depend on the choice of this representation. Here, actually, the situation is much less trivial. It is true that the right-hand side doesn't depend on this representation, but it's not immediately obvious. But this is true. Okay, then. This definition, such triple operator integrals, have also nice Schatten von Neumann properties. That if, for example, T belongs to SP, R belongs to SQ, and 1 over P plus 1 over Q is less than or equal to 1, then the triple operator integral belongs to SR, where 1 over R equals 1 over P plus 1 over Q. Such natural, nice Schatten von Neumann properties. Again, this follows very easily from this definition. Yes. Okay. Now, how such multiple operator integrals can be used in perturbation theory? Let's consider, for example, the problem of the existence of the of high derivatives that takes t to f of a plus tk. I have already explained that if you take the first derivative of this operator function, it can be expressed in terms of double operator integrals. We integrate the divided difference. How about higher operator derivatives? Actually, it turns out that higher operator derivatives can be expressed in terms of multiple operator integrals. If you can see the second derivative, say at zero, then this is the double operator integral d2 f d e a k d e a k d e a, where d2f is the divided difference of the second order. So it can be differences of higher order can be defined inductively. For example, the second divided difference, this, df of s t u is by definition df of s t minus df of s u divided by t minus u. This definition seems not invariant under the change of variables, but actually you can prove very easily that it is invariant. So it doesn't matter in which order you rearrange the variables. Then this formula holds under the assumption that this belongs to the integral projective product under the assumption. This formula holds. And this was proved in my paper in 2005. Well, and again, it is possible to prove that if f belongs to the space of infinity, say, of two variables, and the Fourier transform of f has support in minus sigma squared, then the same estimate holds. Then this second order divided difference belongs to this triple integral projective tensor product. And its norm is less than or equal to a constant times sigma squared this time, sigma squared. Last, when we consider just divided difference, we have the factor sigma. When we consider second order divided difference, we have the factor sigma squared times the L infinity norm of F. And so this formula holds for all functions in the Bessel space B infinity 1, 2 of R. If you consider the Bessel space B infinity with smoothness index 2, then the second derivative can be expressed in terms of such triple operator integrals. And the same is true for all higher order derivatives. You can see the third derivative, we have to consider divided difference of order 3, and we have to use quadruple operator integrals, etc. Consider higher order operator differences. Let's consider the following. F of A plus 2k minus F minus 2f of A plus k plus F of A. This is such a difference as second order. We can consider also third order operator difference, etc. Then it turns out that they also can be expressed as multiple operator integrals. For second order difference, we have to use triple operator integrals. It's d2f. Here we have dEa, then k dEa plus k, k dEa plus 2k. And so we can write a similar estimate for the higher order differences, for the higher order differences. And then we can use the same method as I used today for Hölder functions to prove the following, that if F belongs to the Hölder-Zeugmann class lambda alpha, where alpha is less than 2, then the norm of this second order divided difference is less than or equal to a constant times the norm of F in lambda alpha times the norm of k to the power alpha. And here alpha is an arbitrary number less than 2. In particular, if alpha is equal to 1 and F belongs to the Zeugmann class, which I denote by lambda 1, which means the following, that modulus F of x minus 2F of x plus t plus F of x plus 2t is less than or equal to constant times modulus t, and f is continuous, then such functions are called functions of Zeugmann class. Then the same is true for operators. Then we can replace the real numbers with operators. Then the same is true for operators. The norm of f of a minus 2f of a plus k plus f of a plus 2k is less than or equal to constant times the norm of k. Then if you want to extend this scale of inequalities beyond 2, we have to consider higher order difference. If, for example, if alpha is between 2 and 3, is greater than or equal to 2, but less than 3, we have to consider we have to consider a higher difference of order 4, and etc. Or for the 3, excuse me, etc. And each time we can express such high order difference in terms of multiple operator integrals and obtain similar estimates. Again, we can also generalize this case to arbitrary moduli of continuity of higher orders or moduli of smoothness. Some people call them moduli of smoothness. We can generalize this result for moduli of smoothness. And we can also obtain Schatten von Neumann estimates for higher order operator differences under the assumption that F belongs to lambda alpha. Again, those results were obtained in my joint paper with Alexey Alexandrov in 2009. Okay, then, let me just say a few words what I'm going to do next. So I have defined today multiple operator integrals, and in this case the integrand belongs to the integral project and the product. Not long ago, in the paper by Yushchenko, Todorov, and Turovska, they introduced multiple operator integrals for functions that belong to the Hogerup tensor product. And actually, this is this class is bigger than the class of function that I used. But actually, the definition, if we consider the Hogerup tensor product, that we do not have such nice Schatten von Neumann properties as in the case of projective tensor products. So we have some advantages, we have some disadvantages. Okay, next time I will define such multiple operator integrals when the integrand belongs to the Hogerup tensor product. And actually it turned out that if we use, if we want to consider the problem of perturbations of pairs of non-commuting self-adjoint operators, which I'm going to do next. I'm going to consider functional calculus for non-commuting self-adjoint operators. Then we need triple operator integrals. And actually, considering projective or integral projective tensor products doesn't help at all. And even, and actually, even the Hogerup tensor product do not help. So I'm going to modify the definition of the Hogerup tensor product to consider what we call Hogerup-like tensor products, which is not the same. And it turns out that actually this will work. This will work. And so I'm going to do this next time. A few remarks about the authors of this paper who introduced multiple operator integrals for Hogerup tensor product. One of the authors is Yekaterina Yushchenko. And as you know, that you certainly know this name because it is the wife of the former Orange Ukrainian president, Viktor Yushchenko. Her name is Yekaterina Yushchenko, and she was a CIA agent who brought to the airplane to the seat near Yushchenko to get married to Yushchenko then to organize the Orange coup in Ukraine in 2005. But I just this remark that you should not mix these two people. Yekaterina Yushchenko, who is the author of this paper, is not the same as Yekaterina Yushchenko, who is the wife of the ex-president in Ukraine. This is a very important remark.